So, automatic testing of logical properties. I have a function like this. I say, okay, delete this value from this list of elements. And then I need the property, for instance, for any element and then any list of elements. If you delete an element from the list, then it's not longer an element of the list. I can write such property.
But if it's a bag, it may not be a desirable property.
Which one?
If it's a bag, I mean, you're using lists here. You could say delete deletes the first occurrence.
Depends on the deletions, of course. And of course, it can also be.
But you said a desirable property. I was only.
This property is. Nevertheless, in order to test these things, my test system has to generate lists and values here. That's in this. And the results of testing depends on the values generated by the test system in order to evaluate this property. And this talk is about the generation of test data. So not about the property, not on the delete function of so what kind of test data do we need? Well, suppose I have domain here, this is the length of the list, this is the elements of the list. There can be errors here, which are just the base cases, and of course I want to discover them. And of course, in general, this is a recursive function. So if there is an error in a base case, it's also repeated in large cases, and those are reduced to the base case. And there's a process called shrinking. So okay, if I a large value here, then there's an automatic and systematic way to try to find a small case which represents the same thing. And these small cases are of course better because that makes much easier to debug. It's also possible that the critical test cases are not the base cases, but it's something larger. For instance, I need a tree of depth 2, at least 2, to find that there's a balancing problem or things like that. So not simple base cases, but some of base cases. And there are also situations where you find problems only with rather large test cases. For instance, I suppose to have a queue, and it appears to be a finite queue rather than an infinite queue, and if you hit the bound, then you find an error, and otherwise you don't. And of course, it's also possible that there's somewhere out in my data space a tiny little error which is only isolated and found there. These things are very rare in polymorphic recursive functions, but if you want, you can write them, and of course, it's very hard to find them automatically. So, if you don't find those, then okay, we don't find those in automatic testing. But the other ones I want to find. So, what approaches are there for test data generation? For instance, you can do it in a pseudo-random way. So, okay, here's my data space, and I'll fix some values there and see if I can find it. That's easy, and there's a fair chance that if there's an error or a counter example for my property, it will be found. The drawback is, of course, despite shrinking, even small counter examples can escape. And of course, if you can see here my large counter example, it will probably escape and I can't help. The other thing is, there's a fair chance, but not better than a fair chance that I will discover. And they rely on shrinking to find small things. The other thing is, okay. I have a systematic generation and try from small to large each and every possible value and discover the counter examples. If there's a plant example, there's almost always a small one, and I discover those small ones. So that will
work.
This is in the class test system, and also SmallTech uses a similar approach. So we find counter examples, that's good. And often we find counter examples much more efficient than in random testing. If you look at the number of tests needed, it's usually much more. And if you do it systematically and you have a final type, then at some point you can say, okay, now I've tested each and every possible value, so I know the property holds, I have improved by exhaustive testing, which is also nice. And of course, I've never will repeat the test, and this is also useless in the functional language. It holds for one thing, one time, then the next time it will use exactly the same result, so it holds also. The drawback, of course, is that it can take too long or very long or longer than you want to wait. And to find a large counter example, there's a large counter example here, and at this point you stop. This is the counter example here, you stop. Then it escapes. And so, okay, I've tested the things that, well, it wasn't the test, but it ends. And of course, this is a simple picture, but in reality, things are a little bit more complicated because you generate all kinds of permutation. If I look at the length of generated list in a systematic way, here is the list, and here are the things, and here is the table. Then you see, well, if I have only 100 test cases, then the maximum length is 4, and there are only 3 lists of length 4 generated. And I can, of course, increase the number of test cases to 10,000, and then the maximum length is 5, which is still very limited. And I gain in fact 100 in the number of test cases, but only 1 in the length of the list.
This
is systematic generation.
This is a system.
Yeah. So yes, it works, but my lists are of a limited in length.
Of course, there are.
That's a pity. Maybe we're going to mix it, those things. I do it systematically and add some randomness in order to gain a large list. So I'll do it kind of this way, add some random things and some systematic things. And of course, then the problem is, well, that's kind of a good idea, and I'll try to combine best approach. The only problem is, how much randomness do I need? If I add much randomness and let it systematic things, yeah, then I lose the good things of the systematic things. I only have the random things. And if I use many systematic things and a few random test cases, then I perhaps miss still those large test cases. Test system cost has this since the beginning, a little randomness. And it works every now and then. But. Of course, the real solution is say, okay, I want to do it in a systematic way, but I want to generate long lists earlier. So instead of doing this way, I said, well, I have to make a combination for a cons of an element and a recursive list. If I give preference to the recursive situation, like this, and I get this order of list, I get much larger list earlier in the test cases, and of course, the price to be paid is that I have less variation in the values of the list, but for most polymorphic functions, the values are not interesting at all. Of course, I need some equal things and some unequal things, but 2 and 3 are usually as good as 4 as 5, so that's not much reason I do it. So instead of doing it in a fair way, I do it in a skew way. So okay, the number of things I'll take here in this direction, I call this the skew factor. So if I conclude again, measure again the length of the list. This is my old situation. Now I have 1,000 test cases generated. And you see, if I increase the skew factor, then also the length of the list, which occur in my test set, are longer and longer. And here, in this situation, there is kind of a fair distribution in the length of the list, which rather distribution as this one, which is the skew factor one, the old systematic situation. Well, some examples. Here is the delete function, and indeed it proves that even a correct delete function finds a counter example because my property is wrong in this situation instead of the delete function is wrong, so you are completely right. Nevertheless, the systematic generation is skew factor 1. I need 7 test cases in order to find this, and this better skew factor. I gain almost a factor of 2, but only 3 test cases, so that's not really. Hughes also reports this case for random testing, and he needs 300 something test cases, so systematic generation is much more efficient. My next example, I have queues, and I have a queue of length 5, and I said, okay, my property is I have a queue and a set of characters in this situation. I enqueue all those characters, they queue them again, and what I obtain is the same list as I enqueue. Okay, skew factor 1, the old situation, I need 218,000 test cases before a sufficient long list is generated. If I increase the skew factor a little bit, even the skew factor of 2, it's reduced to 800 something things. And that's good news. The default number of test cases is 1,000, so this one is detected and this one escapes undetected. And if the skew factor increases, the number of test cases reduces. That's fine. So also in this situation, skewing the skew factor is better. And here it really helps in the previous situation. It helped a little bit, but not that much. Here I have the property of function computing the indices. In a list I have a value and a list of things, and it produces a list of integers, and these integers are the indices of that element in the list. And of course, I made an error in order to make this interesting, this testing interesting. So, with a skew factor of 1, the old situation, I need 379 tests in order to find the counter example. And it nicely decreases if I increase this skew factor. And then the number of test cases start to increase again. You can understand this, if there are too many elements in the list which are all equal, all zeros, and you look for ones, then yeah, well, it doesn't really matter if there are a list of length 4 or 4 zeros, or a list of 5 zeros, or 7 zeros, it all shows the same. So yeah, often it's better, skew factor, and the larger the better, but there are examples where a skew factor like 3 is the best. Actually, there are more examples which this kind of behavior. And the nice thing is that they all show that the skew factor of 3 happens to be the best situation. So, I don't know that there's no theory behind it or something. But 3 is the default skew factor now in my test system. 3 is a nice thing. okay, well, this is for list, and of of course, I want a generic algorithm saying, okay, give me an arbitrary type, and I want to give a list of instances of this type. So, okay, what I do is say, okay, the type like this, I take the generic representation and start generating things in the generic representation, and the system will have me transform them back to me to the values. So I say, okay, this is my generic type. I have an item saying this is a choice between the nil and the const. And perhaps you say, okay, then I have to switch there to give references to the recursive situation, which is not true. There's only one nil here, and a lot of the other strings here, and you need to generate the nil first in order to ensure termination. Here you need this skew factor. Okay, I have the elements of the list and the recursive situation, and I have to make combinations of those things, and I can say, okay, give me one value, and I'll start combining it with many recursive situations there in order to increase the length. So here is where the skew factor matters. Well, in this situation it's easy, but in general there can be all kinds of recursive situations, and I have to take care. For instance, if I have a tree, well then there are two recursive situations, and moreover the non-recursive thing is here on the right, was on the left, so I have to find this dynamic and say, okay, where's the terminating situation and where is the recursive situation. And maybe there are more recursive situations and I have to give references to them all. But not to this thing in the middle. Those are values stored in the tree. Usually they are not very important. I can have a rose tree where the recursion is more here in the list. So the rows, the type rows A is an element of the list rather than a direct recursion. We can have a type like this, which looks pretty harmless, not recursive at all. And again, a type like this, also pretty harmless, not recursive at all. But those things are mutual recursive, so there is recursion, and I need some additional way to find that. I can have a record. All records are harmless. They are never recursive types, you know. Well, in this situation, it can be. So, could be three. Good investigation. Say, okay, which type is recursive, also indirect recursion matters, and I'll need to work a little bit.
Sorry, do you do all of this, or these are all things you should do?
Well, I do this, and these things. Currently, the generic system has not enough information in order to detect it. I can find only a look at the definition of the type and not on the definition of all the types. You can do it, but it's very complicated.
Okay.
So the good way to do it is to change the generic system within a little bit. And we're talking to John to convince him that we need more information and we're looking for the best solution there. This works pretty well. You say, okay, here I see exactly the same behavior as for the list. Here I measure the depth of the tree instead of the length of the list. And you see with a skew factor 1, very many trees, there's a limited depth, and if I increase this skew factor, then I get longer and longer, or deeper and deeper trees. Here, skew factor 1, no trees, this depth 4 or bigger handle, and if I increase this skew factor, exactly what they want. So, those are the interesting situations. I go to pseudo random testing and say, okay, systematic thing is there. My improvement was okay. Make systematic generation with those preference to the recursive situation and make a longer list of deeper trees. This gives more efficient testing. Of course, I can ask, well, why not skew in the other direction? Is it also useful? Well, for polymorphic things, usually not. But if you say, okay, there's a function really computing with these integers in the list, then it's also important to look more at the values of these integers instead of the length of the list. For instance, computing the sum and overflow things, things like that. So, yeah, if there's a focus on values, so the type is really list of int instead of list of x's with some class restriction, then this is a good way to use. I can also combine this, of course. So make a thing like this. This is kind of a systematic variant of what's called pairwise testing in the literature, saying, okay, it's good to make combinations of values, but usually two zeros is okay, but for the next one, better look at all the value. It's the chance that that really has three values add something to the test. If you have tested the list with two zeros, this probability is pretty large. So this looks perhaps well. And I have a new implementation of my generation algorithm. This is almost all, except that this much shorter recursion is not detected, but you can do a skew generation, then okay, I'll go to the recursive situation or to the data thing. It's fine, I count examples quicker in almost all situations. It finds the non-recursive thing in order to ensure termination, and again shuffle values in order to obtain this thing which goes in the skew. So my conclusion, systematic test data generation has advantages over this pseudo-random thing. It can prove things, small counter examples cannot escape, and they are found very efficiently. They can do proof-based exhaustive testing and all kinds of nice things. But the problem was it can take too long before a sufficiently large list is generated. Well, it's cool, generation fixing that. I'll generate long list earlier and as well. And in some situations this gives a little improvement, and in other situations it gives a huge improvement. And I've tried many examples, and I didn't encounter a real example where it's worse. And of course, if you know what's happening, you can construct a counter example, and that's always possible. If you know the generation strategy, you can come up with an example where this generation strategy is worse than anything else. You can hide with counter examples. But it's kind of a lot of work in order to do it. And generic test data generation works for any type, so that's completely. Questions?
I assume if you have more complex functions or predicates that you want to test, then you have several arguments. So rather than having a two-dimensional test space, you would then have a two times n-dimensional test space.
Yes.
Then my question is, how do you skew between those axes?
Currently, I don't. And if you look at this example or the link example, they are all things with two different arguments, and I only make this skew thing of the list, the recursive things. And of course, you can also try to do there something like this pairwise testing. Say, okay, I can try to remove zero from a list and one from the same list and two from the same list, but at some point you're done. So maybe it's better to also skip things there. Say, okay, I'll have 15 this and I'll skip that. But that's additional. I didn't do this at the moment.
So for your tree example, I'm surprised that the generator actually terminates at all. For your binary tree example,
yes,
how does the generator actually terminate?
For that's that's easy. You look at the type, you say, okay, this thing is non-recursive, So if I have to generate a list of trees, if I make sure that this tip is always the first one of the list, then the thing terminates. And this is also for these recursive situations. I make all kinds of combinations, so I make sure the non-recursive tree, so the tip, is always the first. And of course I have to look if this tree, this non-recursive thing, is the first constructor or the second constructor, or perhaps the 27th constructor if I have a huge complicated type. But I can find out this, and we do that. You just have to look at the type definition, so all these constructors look at a non-recursive thing and say, okay, this is the first value generated in that situation.
So you always hit the tip first.
Yeah.
So I was wondering, so what knowledge about the function do you presuppose? So I was assuming initially you were doing black box testing.
Yeah, I'm black box testing. So
but then you said you're testing the recursive argument, or do you just recognize that from the type?
So I recognize that from the type.
Oh, I see.
I don't know anything about it's black box testing, so I don't know. I can see the properties, say, okay, I have these types of arguments, and that's all I know. So, but I say, okay, if I have recursive type, I can generate the enumerate the values of this type a little smarter instead of the old systematic way. That's everything I know.
Last question?
To follow up, just you say you always pick tip because it's non-recursive. Does it complicate things if you've got lots of non-recursive cases?
No, not really.
Just random choice or? Or exhaustive?
No, it's not what I meant, choice. It's I'll do the skew thing here again, but now I have two places to go to the skew situation. And it's not obvious that the right branch is better than the left one, or the left one is better than the right one. So I'll say, okay, these things are interesting to go into depth, and this value, it's most likely not. Unless you say, okay, I'll really do something with the values in this tree, and then the user can say, okay, in this situation, I want to go inside the value rather than in the recursion.
Okay, thank you.